And I have, you know, I have to tell you that, as it's often the case with our material science students, they come from very different backgrounds. It's not like physics programs where, you know, backgrounds are more uniform all across the board. So Naveen had an MS in material science already from the Rochester Institute of Technology and a BE in metallurgical engineering from Tamil Nadu in India. And he's at UVM, he's been focusing on this project that we had in our group, looking at ordering in organic magnetic semiconductors and low temperatures. But the skills and work he's done go way beyond that. And I want to point out that, unlike many other experimentalists, he is a Renaissance man in some sense, because he's gained wet chemistry skills, some X-ray diffraction, a little bit of X-ray diffraction skills, working at a chess facility in Cornell. He did a little bit of thin film deposition, but mostly his skills lie in the area of optical spectroscopy in high magnetic fields. And here I would like to point out that, in addition to the scientific accomplishment you're hopefully going to hear about soon and his results, Naveen has worked at the split helix magnet facility in Tallahassee when I was there on sabbatical and was instrumental in developing the new ultrafast techniques in that magnet. So he's a technique developer as well as a material scientist. So without further ado, I'll let him tell you about what he did. Oh, I should mention that Naveen has already published one Journal of Physical Chemistry Letters. I believe this is a fairly high impact factor journal. I can tell you, even though we're supposed to be embargoed, but I'm sure the news won't get past this room yet for another couple of weeks, that we were accepted in Nature Communications, and the paper will be coming out in about 2 weeks from now. I can also share with you that you will have very soon another publication, hopefully, in Nature Scientific Reports that we are currently writing the response to the referees, but it looks promising there as well. And of course, if we can have him for a couple of more months around, I think that we will have more good surprises. So, there you go. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Madalina. Of course, I mean, Madalina said it was not a good thing about me, but it was her vision that made all of this possible. Of course, our interests are the same, but it was her vision from the start that made all of this possible. So, today I'll be talking about my research project here, which was on organic magnetic semiconductors. Should we kill the light? Thanks. And basically, I've divided the talk in two sections. Then I'll be introducing the materials and talking about the thalocyanines, how we microscopically order them, and the optical and magnetic properties of these materials. And we look at the magnetic exchange mechanisms that are present in this material. And in the second part, I'll be talking about how all this understanding of optical and magnetic properties helped us in allowing me to tune this action mechanism by making mixed crystalline alloys. So, organic magnetic semiconductors are these new materials or active structures that have generated a lot of interest in the last 10 years. And scientists from different fields are working in this area, and both in theoretical and chemistry, theoretical and experimental. And area, and they have made a lot of progress in understanding the fundamental behavior of these materials. And my work at UVM has basically involved in synthesizing these materials and looking at the spintronics behavior of these materials. So essentially, in spintronics, we are trying to utilize both the magnetic as well as the semiconducting properties of the material. More specifically, we are looking at the spin polarization of the charge carriers in this system. And essentially, at a fundamental level, because we have a wide audience today, we need two things in our system. We need spins that comes from the electrons. We know electrons have spin angular momentum, along with orbital angular momentum. And the other ingredient that we need in the system is the exchange interaction. That is, the spins need to couple to each other through a mechanism. And that mechanism can be very different. So in simplistic scheme I've put here, you can have an exchange interaction between two spins, which can be like a direct exchange, where these magnetic moments of these electrons are very close to each other, and there's some overlap of the wave functions. Or you might have a case where the moments are quite far apart from each other, so they cannot directly talk to each other, but they need an intermediate. And if that is the case, you can, the simplest classification, divide it into RKKY type interaction, where you have some, for example, let's say some charge carriers in the system, equivalent electrons. Or you can have a case where you don't have any charge carriers, for example, in the case of insulators, and then you need non-magnetic ligands, for example, so that this spins can talk to each other. Let me present a few examples of some of the research that was recently published. This group from Leeds has just recently published this paper on heterostructure of copper and C60, which is an organic molecule. And what they saw was that for the first time there was ferromagnetism seen in this heterostructure. And this is quite a development. It just came out earlier this month. And the main cause for this ferromagnetism is now believed to be this exchange between the d electrons of the copper and the pi electrons from the C60. So another example is in the case of phthalocyanines, it's published last year, where it was reported that cobalt phthalocyanine specifically can have large exchange coupling of the order of 100 Kelvin, which is the largest in all of the phthalocyanines reported so far. And they predict that this exchange coupling can be even higher, so it can survive even up to room temperature. This has not happened yet, but that's the theoretical prediction so far. So, and again, in this system, you can have indirect exchange, which they call ligand-dominated exchange here, but it's necessarily indirect exchange because you have charge carriers. Or you can have super exchange. And that all depends on how your molecules stack. So what is the arrangement when you have basically a crystalline thin film? So we have also been working on phthalocyanines, specifically on these organo-soluble metal and metal-free phthalocyanines. And these molecules have this octabutoxy group attached in this non-peripheral position that makes them soluble. And the difference between the metal-free and the metal version is that it has this metal substituted instead of the two hydrogen in the core here. So these materials was, like I said, was first developed as near IR absorbers for drug delivery. So the medical program in Case Western is where they were developed. And then they essentially moved to further IR materials than phthalocyanine. So they didn't really synthesize the cobalt, manganese, and other metallic version of this molecule. So we took this molecule and we ended up synthesizing them. Basically, phthalocyanines, the structure that you see here, it has this alternating carbon-nitrogen, like. And what this does is this leads to pi overlap here, and you get 18 pi electrons in around this core. And this is what we call this delocalized ligand electrons. So essentially, later you will see what we are actually probing is we are seeing the effect of this metal onto this delocalized pi electrons. But in thin films, because a lot of these materials have been investigated in monomer case, where you have just one molecule, but the studies have not happened yet in the case of crystalline thin films. It's only picking up in the last 5 years. So the magnetic properties for this material comes from basically the central metal atom. If you have unpaired spins in the single metal atom, then it can have magnetic properties, or it can spin code as the delocalized charge carriers in the system. So, in the crystalline thin films, at least for the parent phthalocyanine that doesn't have the side chains, one can observe different phases. You can have alpha phase, beta phase, or X phase. And basically, the difference between these is that there is this stacking angle between these molecules. That is, for the alpha case is 25, and for the beta case is 45 degrees. So basically, this stacking angle is the angle between the normal of the plane of the molecule and the stacking axis of between the individual molecules in one chain. So you can also have different stacking between neighboring chains. You can have a herringbone structure like this, or you can have a pi stacking like this. And essentially, X phase is a much more complicated phase of, it can be either alpha or beta phase, but you necessarily get two molecules per unit cell and they are not equidistant apart from each other. So depending on all this crystal arrangement, you get wide varieties of molecular properties in this system. And as I mentioned earlier as well, depending on the metal that you have, you can end up with different ground state spins in the system. So this is simplistic picture. For copper, you end up with a spin half system. For iron, it can be a spin one system. And for manganese, you end up with a spin three half system in the ground state. And in the case, for example, copper and cobalt, where you have spin half system, the spins can lie in different orbitals, and that in itself can impart different magnetic properties in the system. And I'll show you the results later. And the people have observed this recently in Germany, where they saw the effects of the different magnetic molecules in the center. As well as I mentioned earlier, if you have beta phase or alpha phase, it can also affect your magnetic properties as well. For example, in manganese here, you can see there is ferromagnetic coupling for the beta phase. But if you have alpha phase of manganese PC, you end up with anti-ferromagnetic. So the way we synthesize this molecule is we use this indirect approach, where you start with the thalamidyl precursor and you substitute your butoxy group instead of the hydrogen here. And essentially, this is flexible. You can modify your starting precursor and substitute them in different positions, start with a different butoxy group, different group other than the butoxy, depending on what you want. So we had some knowledge that yeah, this molecule will work for fabricating of thin films. So we stuck with this, and basically once you have a precursor, you can tetramerize it and form this metal-free version of the thalocyanine. And of course, because of the symmetry, you can see that in the absorption band, you see this slight splitting in the Q-band gap because of the difference between this molecule. And we take this molecule and basically we do a reflex reaction with the metal salt and replace the two hydrogens with the metal. And essentially, once you have the metal substituted in the center, you raise the symmetry to D4H. You can rotate it 180 degrees and then you lose this degeneracy. And that's why you will observe only one single peak in the absorption. And we also confirmed this by running NMR and IR data. And in fact, so I was able to synthesize the cobalt, manganese, and zinc thalocyanines. However, I was not able to make the iron molecule. It was too reactive. Every time I tried to isolate it at room temperature, it would just react and oxidize. So, but I was able to form at least these three. And copper one is commercially available, so we were just able to purify it and use this material. And one good thing about the chemistry is that these materials, they grow under UV, so it's very easy to work with when you're purifying them. And, in fact, I've worked with a lot of different molecules. I've worked with smaller size molecules that are porphyrins, and even larger size molecules that are anthracyanines. And Lane is working on the project investigating the optical properties of those materials. But today I'll be focusing on these thalocyanines. So, as you might have guessed, all of these molecules are can be used for solution processing because they have these side attached. And a lot of different solution processing methods have been developed recently. and basically one can use them for flexible and large area scale electronics, and you can control your grain morphologies in this through solution processing very easily, and minimize the defects and grain boundaries in this system. And that is critical, because once you have that, you can employ optical spectroscopy techniques and understand what's happening by looking at the transition between the states and understanding the interactions that are present in the system. So, as some of you might already know, that the technique that we use at UVM is the hollow penwriting technique, which was developed by Dr. Hendrick. And essentially, in this technique, you have your solution loaded in a capillary, and you have a motor that drives your substrate. And once the solvent makes contact with your substrate, depending on the direction of movement of translation of the stage, you can grow these macroscopic order grains. So we were able to successfully synthesize the metal-free version and the metal ones, and then eventually even make the thin films of long range order, which was our goal. So we're very happy with the result. And these grains that you see here, that is the bright grain, is basically all the molecules, they are stacked along this penwriting direction. And the bright and dark regions in this image is basically the neighboring grains have different stacking of the molecules as compared to the grain in the middle. So the scale bar in this image is about 500 microns. So these are substantially large grains with, as you can see, there are no defects in this grain. And what solution processing also helps us achieve is that we have seen that there are long-range interactions that happen in the system. And this leads to delocalization along this stacking axis of the excitons. And also, we observed that there are new bandgap states that are formed in the thin films that are not present in the monomer. For example, this is the absorption for the metal-free molecule, and you can see that there is this redshifted state here that was not present in the monomer. As well as, even in the case of the metal ones, we have observed redshifts and new states that are not present. And again, I want to emphasize that it's the purification that is critical for achieving this macroscopic grain sizes. So what you see here is thin films written at different deposition speeds, but they have all been column chromatographed once. And this is through the second column, and this is the third column. So I have to find out different solvent combinations so that I could achieve the best purification in these materials. But eventually, if you optimize the concentration and deposition speed and your material is pure enough, you can achieve these long range ordered grain sizes. So as I mentioned earlier, if you can create these macroscopic grain sizes, you can use optical spectroscopy techniques, such as the one that we developed in our lab. It's called the dual linear dichroism photoluminescence imaging. And basically, in this technique, we have this laser that is focused onto the sample. So you can see the sample here with the two grains and our laser spot that is focused right here. So you can investigate what is happening with the charge carriers or the excitons in this system at the grain boundary or within a single grain. And we can record the emission basically in the backscattering geometry, just like a normal microscope. But at the same time, what this technique does is we can do transmission, because these films are deposited on sapphire, so they are transparent. And you can now correlate your structure and stacking of your molecules to the emission of the excitons. And that basically gives us further information about how these charge carriers behave. And we were able to understand that, yes, so there is extended pi orbital overlap that exists in this system. And the way these molecules stack leads to this delocalization of the wave function here is extending over at least 10 different molecules. And we were also able to do the X-ray for these thin films and confirm the crystallinity of these materials. We saw very good focused spots here, and we were able to assign all of them to the existing literature. And essentially, this is a little bit background about the optical and structural properties of the materials. But when it comes to the magnetic properties, we think of this system as being analogous to the diluted magnetic semiconductors. So the DMS systems were developed starting from the 80s, and basically in these systems you have a magnetic impurity that is doped into your 2-6 or 3-5 semiconductor, and basically you are replacing the cadmium with manganese. And there are. And what was seen that if you replace and put in small amount of this magnetic impurities, it doesn't deteriorate the semiconducting properties of the material. However, you start observing this large Faraday rotations, and also you start observing higher TCs or transition temperatures of magnetic ordering in these materials. And the way the theory is believed to exist and this occurs in this molecule is because of this SPD exchange interaction. So you have this D electrons that come from the manganese, and S and P are the basically the valence band and the conduction band of your semiconductor, and this interaction basically leads to enhanced Riemann splitting of the states and causes very large effective G factors in this system. So this system basically, if you consider a case where these spins are non-interacting or we have very dilute concentration of manganese, it basically follows a Poulenc function behavior, and you can see here it fits very well. However, when there is this SPD exchange interaction, you have to take that into account in your Hamiltonian, and one can get the expression for the energies in terms of this effective G factor, which is dependent on this band G factors as well as on the magnetization. And through magnetization, it is also temperature dependent, which is critical because you need temperature dependence in your to observe that yes, these states are spin polarized. And one of the main assumptions that is done is that for the thermal averaging of the spins here is that the electronic wave functions are extended to a large number of light sites, which is the problem. And although we are not in this perfect case where our wave function and molecular overlap is extending to a large number of molecules, but at least we have some kind of delocalization, or the charge can move at least to some number of molecules in our system. So we believe that we are very close to the case for DMS systems. And basically the way we look at the spin polarization of these charge carriers in the system is by performing magnetic circular dichroism. And in this technique, we measure the difference in the absorption of the left and right circularly polarized light in the presence of magnetic field. And from the expression that was derived earlier for the DMS system and the expression that comes about from the MCD, we can equate these two and calculate the effective G factors for any state involved in the transition. As long as you consider that, yes, there is some kind of exchange interaction. And MCD is one of the few techniques that is used to measure the spin polarization of this bands in semiconductors. For example, for the manganese doped gallium nitride, where it was believed that you know, it has room temperature ferromagnetism and it will affect all the charge carriers, when they eventually performed MCD, they saw that there was no signal, there was no magneto-optical active states there. So they couldn't prove that there is spin polarization of charge carriers in this system. And this material eventually ended up being used for magnetic storage devices. So MCD is one of the few techniques that can help us prove that you do have spin polarization of charge carriers. So the principle of MCD is very simple, and this was developed by the previous graduate student, Dr. Benna. And basically, we are using the polarizer and PEM setup, and this dual locking technique in essentially helps us to measure with a very high signal to noise ratio your changes in the plane of polarization of the light. And we can simultaneously measure the MCD as well as absorbance in this system. And the setup for the MCD is shown here in our lab. And all the preliminary experiments we did with our 5 Tesla magnet and the 1 Tesla room temperature magnet. But as many of mentioned, some of the higher DOT measurements I have performed in the 10 Tesla magnet in Dr. McGill's lab and then the 25 Tesla magnet at the National Laboratory. So let's look at the preliminary results that we have got in UVM. And basically, all I wanted to focus here on is that you can see how the band gap, which is this red curve, which is the MCD, changes when you have different metals in the system. And this was very promising, so we moved ahead with this and we looked at copper, which was the first system that we investigated at high BORT, and we were able to find the state that was involved in this exchange interaction with the D states, and we were able to calculate the effective G factor for the state, and we saw that it is around 6. So there is some spin polarization of the state happening, and essentially we also found out that there is delocalization from the plane in the system that makes these states MCD active. And essentially this state is close to 651 nanometers in our system. And this is the paper that is under review that Martin was saying. The next system that we looked at was the cobalt thalocyanine. And just a little bit of background about cobalt thalocyanine. It is believed that super exchange coupling is the major mechanism in this system. And cobalt PC has been investigated, the parent PC without the substituted side chains on different substrates, and the properties do change a little bit. And as I had mentioned, depending on your stacking angle in the molecules, you can have either indirect exchange that is dominating, or you can have super exchange that is dominating. So these are our MCD results for the cobalt OVPC thin film. And we were able to again find the states that were involved in spin polarization, which was around 618 nanometers. However, we saw that it almost dies at 5 Kelvin, so it's kind of weak. And we also found states in the closer to the band gap, excitonic states here, which have large shifts in energy and this non-linear behavior. And these states are the ones which we believe are actually hybridized between the T and the pi. And the way we know this is because we did the Zeeman spreading fitting of the to extract the G factors. And if you see for the 680 nanometer state, you get the highest effective G factor in the system. And the effective G factors for the other two states are very low, so they don't get affected that much. So we agree that all of this is hybridizing with the DC square orbital. It is not causing spin polarization of the charge carriers. And essentially, we also did linear dichroism study. This was done by Lane Manning. And basically, what we saw is that once if you maximize the signal inside a single grain, we saw that the angle of the stacking of these molecules is actually 47 degrees. And then it made all sense as to why we are seeing this weak competing mechanisms right here, because we are basically in this regime here, where you have this weak indirect exchange as well as super exchange present in the system. So we are hoping that if we can change the way this molecule stack, maybe we can tune this a little bit and achieve even higher coupling in this molecule. So Magnus PC was the next one, and this one is a much more complicated system because you have three spins, and there is still debate over what is the ground state of the system, whether the three spins are in three different orbitals, or if they are in the DZ square and the EG orbital here. And there's still a lot of debate going on about what is the actual mechanism for the long range magnetic order in the system. And super exchange is one of them, where if depending on which orbital is interacting with the PCs, you can have either ferromagnetic or antiferromagnetic. So as I shown earlier, depending on the phase, you can have different types of couplings in this gear. And indirect exchange hasn't been investigated a lot, but it does happen in the system and it is believed to happen, but theoretical calculations are not able to predict them properly yet. So these are the MCD results for the magneto-pl molecule, and a couple of things what we saw is that some states, you know, evolve readily with Furis, some states they saturate very fast, and basically I have shown here the three most important states that we believe exist in the system. So one is this dxy orbital state, which, you know, is because it is so similar to the one in copper, that it is weakly spin polarized, saturates and faster. So we believe it is similar to the character that is existing in the copper in one of those levels. And then there are these states which is at the 577 nanometer that is saturated, and at 1269 nanometer, which is much lower than your actual band gap of your DL. So let's focus on these two, which we believe is from these orbitals. And this lower energy band gap states, they are quite unique to manganese. I mean, even in the ELS experiments, they were not observed for any other system, but only for manganese. They were observed because this is our normal band gap of the phthalocyanine. And the reason this happens is because of the symmetry, that the dxzyz symmetry, which is Eg, and of the metal, and the Eg symmetry of your ligands is similar, so they tend to hybridize, and then they try to form this states which are lower in energy than the band gap, and then you can observe transitions between the ground states and Eg to even higher states. And of course, these states are temperature dependent, and if you try to fit the Bjorn function, it doesn't fit very well. So you have to use higher G values to fit it. So it does show this ferromagnetic type of response of faster saturation than your Bjorn function. And however, if you look at the effective G factor, it is not very large. It is actually only one. So we believe that this is because of the hybridization between this dxzyz and Eg. If you look at the 577 nanometer feature, it is completely different in the sense that if you look at the effective G factors that come from the Zeeman splitting, they are quite high. So there is definitely signs of spin polarization in this state, and also this state is the one that is the most temperature dependent as well. And again, if you try to fit it with the Bjorn function, it doesn't fit very well. Common is for the G equals to 2 system, so you have to use higher G values to fit it. And we also did this one over MCD plot to look at the coupling strength in this material, and we see that at lower temperatures we see this strong coupling strength than ferromagnetic. And if you extract from the higher temperatures, which people usually do, you get a weak So there are these, so it's a very complicated system. There are spins in different levels and they are interacting in different manner. And we were able to confirm this by doing squid measurements, as we saw that you do have ferromagnetic ordering of 44 Kelvin, and then there is a transition that happens in the material that goes to this ferromagnetic response. And surprisingly, even from the squid measurements, we see that there is weak ferromagnetic coupling there. And this is somewhat consistent with the results for observed by previous groups as well a long time ago on beta phase manganese PC, and they did observe this kind of behavior, but they didn't have that much resolution as we have today. So they saw a small thing and they were like, this is probably because of the competing exchange mechanism. This in fact is true for this material. So just to summarize, I mean, we were able to explain that this is different kind of exchange interactions in this system, and as you must have seen, it's a rich system. You know, you have different kind of exchange. Even in the same material, you can have this coupling behaving in different manner. And in copper PC, we saw that there was indirect exchange that was mediated by the pi electrons, but in manganese PC, it was much more complicated, and there is strong hybridization. as well as spin polarization of the charge carriers. And but in what we see, we saw only signs of weak spin polarization and hybridization, which we believe is because of the beta phase. And so all this knowledge about the exciton delocalization and the magnetic properties helped us in tuning this exchange interaction in this period. And we ended up making metal and metal free alloys of this of these materials. So essentially what we are doing is we are just mixing them together because they are both organo soluble. And in a sense you can understand that if you have a chain and this is your stacking axis, as you are changing the ratio, basically you are changing the distance between the metal metal atom in this chain. And of course you can tune this exchange, we believe, only up to a certain delocalization length in your system. And if you have infinite delocalization of your charge carriers in the system, then you can couple it to that delocalization length. But we had to investigate what is the delocalization length in our system, and we have already done that. These films, as you can see here, are the films of the cohort mixed systems. So we were able to preserve the macroscopic order, and this data I got from Lane Manning, and he was the main guy behind forming these films. And we also see that there was this phonon coupling and extended delocalization along the stacking axis in these materials. And we were able to do focused white light absorption within a single lens to see how the absorption looks. And there is some difference in the thickness, but you see that the states evolve fairly well. And also, if you compare the absorption of the individual metal-free and metal molecules, you see that the mixed systems has the characteristics of both of these materials. And of course, we have also done GIXRT, which we are analyzing at the moment. And essentially, I don't want to spend too much time on this, but you can understand this emission in the sense that this is your delocalized excitonic emission in your material. So as soon as this first one here is basically 1:1 ratio, that is you have one metal and you have one metal free molecule. So basically you have taken this delocalization length scale and stopped it abruptly. So there is no more delocalization. So you can see that for 1:1, as soon as you put a metal in front of a metal free, you lose this charge carrier emission from this state. And of course when you have two of metal free and one of metal, you have some length of this delocalization in your system. So, and when you have, for example, 10 metal free molecules, so your delocalization length scale is about 10 molecules. And then you have a metal. So that acts as basically a barrier to this system. And that was one of the main reasons that we saw that yeah, the delocalization length scale is about 10 molecules. And so for the MCD studies, I investigated basically all these molecules below that ratio. And I just wanted to present the results for the metal-free version because we are mixing both of these. And as I mentioned before, the metal-free version doesn't have any unpaired spins. So if you look at the evolution of this material, you will see only diamagnetic response, and all the states evolve linearly. So interesting stuff starts happening when you mix these materials together. You see that there is this degeneracy lifting in the few band gap, and these states they start saturating the cluster, and then also our effective G factor starts changing, and then these states also become very strongly temperature dependent than before. And you were able to confirm this. This is the same sample but at lower temperatures. And it saturates even faster, and you see that there are these large energy shifts of happening in this material as well. And I've plotted these energies on the same scale for all the states, so everyone can see which of the states are affected more by the black and red. So we were able to do this for other ratios as well. So for the 3:1 ratio, when you have 3 metals free and 1 cobalt, again you see that there is some signs of saturation in the, especially in these hybridized states. Because at these high temperatures, you have almost killed your spin polarization in this material already. And also, these are the 25 Tesla results for the 5:1 ratio. And here we see that phonon assisted coupling and the activation of these states that happens. And this is quite interesting here. We are still trying to understand why this happens, but you get this large energy shifts in this excitron band gap. And essentially, after 20 Tesla, the states they mix heavily and then they saturate, and you get this drop in intensity. However, if you look at the B band here, which is below the 500, is not affected at all. So this is very surprising. You're still trying to understand, and there is no theoretical background for this mixing yet. But we also observed the effects of spin polarization. So quite interesting stuff happening in this period. And so we did the same thing for manganese as well. And these are the results for 1:1 manganese. As you remember, for the parent manganese, we had observed antiferromagnetic coupling of around 2 Kelvin. And again, this system behaves very differently from, as you can see, from the cobalt. And this state is still robust, it's present here. And it is the one that is again most affected by the temperature. And if you look at the temperature response, you get this ferromagnetic coupling now for these states. And if you dilute the ratio further, you see that the ferromagnetic coupling changes to and goes to even higher, to about 10 Kelvin. And again, in the whole Q band gap states here, only this 575 state is the one that is most affected with temperature, which is a good sign. So, and for 5:1 again, we see that there is ferromagnetic coupling, but it goes down. So it basically kind of oscillates into very high antiferromagnetic and then weakly ferromagnetic, strongly ferromagnetic, and then kind of oscillating in that sense. And that's why we believe this is analogous to the RKK white interaction in this case. And you can see from this comparison that I put here, as soon as you put basically a metal free next to the metal, you lose this coupling between the metal in the case of OBPC. So this big graph is for a complete chain of manganese OBPC, and as soon as you put the metal free in between, you lose this coupling or hybridization between the molecules, complete drop of the signal, and then it doesn't get affected that much. So this is quite interesting. And I would just like to conclude that we were able to tune the exchange interaction in this material, and the extended delocalization length of the pi electrons is also an important criteria for tuning the exchange interaction, especially in our case. And that really helped us in understanding what is going on in this system. And magnetic species films, they exhibit this change in the exchange coupling from interferometer to and we believe that this is the possible RKKY envelope to the system. So I just wanted to quickly mention about the stuff that even Madalina mentioned that we have already put out there. And basically we plan to finish the rest of the papers as well, and most of the optical stuff is Lane has already finished the paper for that one as well. And of course this would not have been possible because we had a very big collaboration actually. And of course Madalina was leading from the front. None of this would have been possible without her. And also other group members in my group, they helped immensely. I mean, each experiment that I had to do was done over a full day, 24 hour period, and I did only half of it. So they have how the contribution is theirs. So, and of course, all the high B over T measurements were done in Florida, in Dr. McGee's lab. And of course, we used the expertise of Dr. Hendrik and his students to make in flux. The grazing instruments, XRT scans, were done in Cornell. And for the spirit measurements, Dr. Kilansky had us at the Polish Academy of Sciences. And of course, Dr. Waterman's group. I mean, each and every student in his group has helped me a lot. So I mean, I can't thank them enough. Thank you so much. factor basically depends on this, it depends on this band G factors, which is basically the G factor when you have basically zero magnetic field. And it depends on this, primarily on this alpha. So alpha is basically the exchange that is existing between these band electrons. And the way we understand it for now is that you always have this Coulomb interaction between the d electrons and the sp electrons, and that causes this coupling to be antiferromagnetic. And then, but at the same time, there is another effect that can also happen, which is the hybridization, because the d electrons and the p electrons can hybridize also, so that can lead to ferromagnetic coupling. So you have both these scenarios occurring in the system, and that's how this essentially this exchange interaction occurs. And that the sign of this alpha basically determines whether you will have a reduction of this effective G factor, or if the exchange coupling is very high, you can have this high effective G factors in the system, because this G star is basically considered to be negative. So if alpha is really high, then this G factor can actually change sign, become very strong.
But I think that Jacobs was wondering, how is this derived in the first place, right? So
how is it derived?
Yeah. So if you can explain what those component terms mean and how you arrive at that energies, and what is E with the arrow up and V with the arrow down.
Yeah, so basically this is just a Landau level with spin up and spin down. And basically you put the exchange term in your Hamiltonian, and you have to make the assumption that the electronic wave functions are extending over a large number of lattice sites. So you have a thermal averaging of your magnetic spins. Then you take your spin average out of your summation, and then you are left with this coupling term in the system, and that gives you this basically the alpha and beta, that is the coupling strength of these two integrals that are involved for the band gap states in your semiconductor.
That's the Zeeman statement, right? The difference between those two energies.
Yeah, and when you take the difference, when you take the difference between these two, you end up with the Zeeman splitting of the energy levels, which is G effective. Yes.
More question. Going back to, I think, the second slide.
Sorry.
Why the clouds?
This one?
No, second. No, the one you're talking about, you have 18 fine electrons. How do you count 18?
Yeah, because from they are coming from the pi by bond between the carbon and the metal.
So each double bond has a.
So they are not. They are alternating double bonds. They are double bond and then single bond. Double bond and single.
So one double bond and one single bond contribute to one pi electron.
So this double bond they have two, right? For this here, right here. One is on this end and one on the other end, right?
So, my question is, you have a four-fold symmetry.
We have a two-fold symmetry here.
It's two-fold symmetry?
Yeah.
Oh.
Because there are two hydrogens here. So this is a D2H symmetry.
Okay. Thank you.
The metal has four-fold symmetry.
Yeah. I'm glad.